Macmillan Audio presents When the Killer Man Comes, Eliminating Terrorists as a Special Operations Sniper by Paul Martinez with George Galdorisi. Read for you by Paul Martinez with a foreword read by Nicholas Irving.
Foreword. America has one force with a single mission of direct action to capture or kill the enemy, the 75th Ranger Regiment. The Special Operations Force, part of the U.S. Army Special Operations Command, is a unique and distinct entity within the U.S. military. No other unit in any other U.S. military service has this singular mission of direct action. Rangers stand alone as the most active brigade-sized unit in the U.S. Special Operations Command, the lead U.S. combatant command engaged in the global war on terrorism. Since 9/11, the 75th Ranger Regiment has been the only continuously engaged unit in the U.S. Army, and for the last decade and a half, 40% of those deployed have been in harm's way. Their mission is unique. Rangers don't patrol, don't train allied forces, and don't engage in routine counterinsurgency duties. They have a single focus: to seek out the enemy and capture or kill them. Today's 75th Ranger Regiment traces its roots to the century before the American Revolution, when colonists in Maryland and Virginia began to organize groups of men to patrol the perimeters of their holdings as a means of early warning of Indian attacks. In 1675, a full century before America's War for Independence, in response to the attacks by the Wampanoag, the governor of the Plymouth Colony had Benjamin Church raise a company of men to conduct scouting and raiding actions against the tribe. Church's written reports included the phrase, "Today we ranged out 4 miles to the west," and thus the word Ranger was born. The term Ranger was used again during the French and Indian Wars, which pitted the New England colonists against the French Canadians. The first Ranger Company was formed by a frontiersman named Robert Rogers. Rogers went on to form 9 additional units. These 10 companies took the fight for the British cause deep into French territory. Robert Rogers' Ranger Standing Orders, written in 1759, is quoted in the Ranger's Handbook, which is issued to every U.S. Army Ranger today. The Rangers continued to lead the way in America's wars. In 1775, the Continental Congress authorized the formation of a number of companies of expert riflemen. General George Washington called these companies his Corps of Rangers. During the Revolutionary War, Colonel Francis Marion, widely known as the Swamp Fox, conducted direct action raids against the British Army, a harbinger of today's Ranger operations. Ranger campaigns continued in the following century. In 1835, the General Council of the Provisional Government formed the Corps of Rangers to protect settlers of the fledgling Republic from marauding Comanche. This force then played a prominent role during the struggle for Texas independence, and later in the Mexican-American War. In the Civil War, both the Union and the Confederacy used Rangers to take the fight behind enemy lines. The exploits of the Confederate Ranger John Mosby, known as the Gray Ghost, provided another link in the chain to today's Rangers. Following the Civil War and through the First World War, Rangers as we know them today all but disappeared from the American military. They resurfaced prominently in World War II. When the United States entered the war, after the December 7, 1941 attack on Pearl Harbor, the country had a peacetime army and no special operations units. Army Chief of Staff General George Marshall authorized the establishment of the 1st Ranger Battalion the following year. 6 additional Ranger Battalions were formed during the war, where they served with distinction, first in the North African and European campaigns, and later in the conflict in the Pacific. The exploits of the Rangers in World War II have been well chronicled in books and film, and their courageous actions have become part of the military, and indeed national, lexicon. From the boys of Pont de Hoc, during the Normandy invasion, to Darby's Rangers in Italy, to Merrill's Marauders in the Pacific, Rangers have taken the fight to the enemy. U.S. Army Rangers continue to distinguish themselves in direct action in the conflicts in Korea and Vietnam. Darby's Rangers deserve special mention. Colonel William Orlando Darby was killed while leading what came to be known as Task Force Darby, part of the Army's 10th Mountain Division, spearheading the breakout of the U.S. 5th Army from the Po River Valley bridgehead, where they were pitted against a large German force. Task Force Darby was sent on a crucial mission against overwhelming odds and walked into an ambush. That tradition will play out in these pages as Paul Martinez tells his story. Today's 75th Ranger Regiment was formally established in 1984 at Fort Benning, Georgia. Since that time, Rangers have fought in every American conflict: Desert Storm, Iraq 1991, Restore Hope, Somalia 1993, Uphold Democracy, Haiti 1994, and Joint Guardian, Kosovo 1999. They currently fight in the Global War on Terrorism. I talked about the 75th Ranger Regiment's actions to ensure America's security and prosperity in my books, The Reaper, St. Martin's Press, 2015, and Way of the Reaper, St. Martin's Press, 2016. Working as an Army Ranger sniper in Iraq and Afghanistan was my way of serving my country, fighting terrorists who would do our nation harm. I finished my service as a Ranger sniper in the 75th Ranger Regiment and moved on to other pursuits, partly because I felt the war in Afghanistan was winding down. That would mean the need for U.S. military, the Rangers, and especially Ranger snipers, would diminish, to the point where I thought I would never face the intense operations I had experienced during my years in uniform. I was wrong. It turned out I missed the most intense action in the global war on terrorism. Soon after I completed my time as a Ranger sniper, our nation made the decision to withdraw from Afghanistan in 2 years. The intention was good, but there were still a large number of senior Taliban and Al-Qaeda leaders and other terrorists in secure locations throughout the country, especially in areas near the border with Pakistan. If the United States was to withdraw from Afghanistan, with these terrorists and their network still intact, they could quickly take over the country and undo all the gains we had made there. These guys needed to be eliminated, and there was only one force to do it: the Rangers. The mission to capture or kill these terrorists was assigned to the 3rd Ranger Battalion of the 75th Ranger Regiment. Naming this unit Team Merrill after the Marauders of World War II fame was prophetic. These Rangers faced near impossible odds, taking on an enemy who knew they were coming and employed every conceivable tactic to kill them. Team Merrill fought for 7 months deep in enemy territory, and like their World War II predecessors, these 21st century Rangers accomplished their mission and beat down the terrorist threat. In doing so, Team Merrill became the linchpin of the U.S. counterterror/counterinsurgency strategy in Afghanistan. My friend Paul Martinez was part of that team, and what he did as a Ranger sniper in Afghanistan helped turn the tide of the conflict in our favor. His experience in these high-risk, high-reward missions, in many cases, efforts that faced near impossible odds, is a story we've all been waiting to hear. I'll stop here and let Paul tell you this story in his own words. Nicholas Irving, San Antonio, Texas.
Preface. He who makes a beast of himself gets rid of the pain of being a man. Samuel Johnson. I grew up in Colorado and, like many young guys, dreamed of adventure. My earliest memories are of wanting to be an astronaut, a fighter pilot, or a sniper. And I was raised with a deep respect for the U.S. military, believing that everyone from Audie Murphy to the doctors in MASH to the men who received the Medal of Honor for their heroics in Iraq and Afghanistan was a hero and a good American. Right out of high school, I didn't feel the calling to join the U.S. military. It's probably because I didn't see the point of being in the peacetime army. Sure, the United States was fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan, but everyone was saying that all would be over soon. Little did we know how long those conflicts would last. Instead, I worked in the tech industry and in construction, not knowing exactly what I wanted to do with my life. Then things changed. I had several close friends come back from Operation Iraqi Freedom with ghosts in their eyes and gravel in their voices. They didn't make it sound like we'd been out of Iraq or Afghanistan anytime soon. Suddenly, the war sounded very real, and my reluctance to be a part of a peacetime army faded away. Now I knew we weren't at peace, and I felt that if we didn't stand together as friends, as brothers, and as a country, we might not make it. I walked into a recruiter's office in Westminster, Colorado, in December 2005, knowing only that I wanted to join the army and get to the fight. When I learned I could qualify for an airborne contract, I was sold. And in April 2006, I was in the army and shipped out for Army Infantry Basic Training at Fort Benning, Georgia. Next came individual training for my military occupational specialty, MOS, as an indirect fire infantryman. What that meant was that I was a mortarman. One of the decisions I made when I decided to write this book was not to dazzle you with military acronyms, but to use them as I would in normal conversation, and then explain what they stand for. From there, it was on to Army Airborne School, otherwise known as Jump School, also at Fort Benning. Things were settling in as I was finishing jump school, and I got my orders to my first unit, the 173rd Airborne Brigade Combat Team, the Sky Soldiers, in beautiful Vicenza, Italy. I was still training at Fort Benning and looking forward to my overseas assignment when my best buddy from basic training, Easy Eisenzimmer, dropped by my barracks and said he had to go to a Ranger indoctrination program briefing. In the Army, you don't go anywhere without a buddy, so I tagged along. I have to admit, though, that it was more than just keeping a buddy company. I think I always knew I wanted to be a Ranger. To start with, they had the best pictures and posters, with lean, camo-faced, hatchet-wielding, badass-looking guys. Their guns always looked light in their hands, and their kits looked like they were a part of their bodies. I had read a book about Rangers while I was in airborne school. It told me a lot, but only so much. They were, well, inscrutable as an organization. They called themselves the nation's direct action raid force, but what did that mean? Easy and I found ourselves in a classroom with a half dozen other soldiers waiting for something, but not sure what it was going to be. Then two tall, lean Army staff sergeants walked in. They didn't say much, they just put on a video. Most of the video was filmed using night vision devices and was a bit hard to see, but we were pretty sure we saw men jumping out of airplanes with dirt bikes. That got our attention. When the film ended and the lights came back on, one of the staff sergeants began his well-polished briefing. It was short and to the point. Men, we want you to think about becoming Rangers. If you decide to try to become Rangers, you will be assessed during a mentally exhausting and physically grueling 30-day indoctrination program. When you graduate, you will be assigned to a Ranger battalion and deployed to Iraq or Afghanistan. What are your questions? Well, that was pretty abrupt. Some of the others asked questions while I processed what I had just heard. Then I couldn't help myself. I raised my hand and said, "Staff Sergeant, is it worth it? I mean, the dangerous training, and then the intense and seemingly endless deployments." I was ready for him to give me a long explanation of why becoming a Ranger was better than what I was going to be doing in the Army, but he didn't do that. He just said, "Do you want to be the best?" I did, and compared with all the other options, I knew if I joined the Rangers, I would get to the fight faster and would go into combat with the best men I could keep up with. I was ready to test my mettle and steel myself for the intense storm I imagined combat would be. Becoming a Ranger meant hard, but it also meant fast. I knew if I made it through Ranger training, I could be in Afghanistan, fast roping out of a helicopter with a machine gun before Christmas. Not to mention, the dirt bikes. The Ranger indoctrination program was demanding. It was the most challenging test I've ever faced. Army basic training had been demanding and jump school had been much tougher than that, but Ranger training pushed me to the limits. I know that many military memoirs, especially those by special operators like me, talk a lot about training. I won't talk about that in this book. One reason is that my main goal is to tell you what it was like to be part of the U.S. military's direct action force in combat in Iraq and Afghanistan. The other reason is that the story of Ranger training has already been told well in Dick Couch's book, Sua Sponte. I graduated from Ranger training, received my tambourine, and became part of the 75th Ranger Regiment, 3rd Ranger Battalion. I was on the ground in Afghanistan fighting on December 28, 2006. Over the next 6 years, I did 6 rotations to Afghanistan. I saw so many of my close comrades die on what can only be called suicide missions that I can't count, let alone name them all here. I could have made being a Ranger my career, but I received a medical discharge because of degenerative disc disease. I know that sounds like an old person's ailment, but it happens to Rangers far too often. I had herniated a disc when I was a mortarman during my 2nd deployment. I was young and strong, and Ranger medicine was a bit different back then. I stubbornly continued training and deploying. By the time we deployed with Team Merrill in 2011, I knew I was living on borrowed time. Multiple herniations led to degenerative disc disease. Said another way, my body had been given a beatdown. 6 deployments in 6 years had left me pretty banged up, and the Army did the honorable thing and medically retired me. I'd been out of the Army for about 2 months when my friend Nicholas Irving said to me, "Paul, I had some tough missions as a Ranger, but I got out before it all hit the fan in 2011. I'm writing 2 books about my time as a Ranger sniper. You need to write a book about what you did, especially all the amazing stuff you did with Team Merrill." I had served with Nick in Afghanistan in 2009. Nick was kind enough to write the foreword for this book, and that should tell you something about how close we are. Nick has the well-earned reputation of being the deadliest Ranger sniper ever, with more than 36 confirmed kills. Nick wrote about his time as a Ranger sniper in 2 books, The Reaper and Way of the Reaper. I know about many of these kills because I worked with him with my squad of Afghan Provisional Army. I hadn't read Nick's first book, the 2nd one hadn't been published yet, and writing a book was the furthest thing from my mind. But the more I thought about it, the more I decided that the Team Merrill story did need to be told, as well as a larger story of what had intrigued me as I did my research before joining the Rangers. Just what did the nation's direct action raid force do for our country? I wanted to tell that story today, not wait decades before some historian or journalist decided to tell it. Not that I have anything against either of those professions, they do good work, but they didn't have the first-person experience I did. Nick continued to challenge me to write this book, telling me, "You need to tell this story. People need to hear how leaving a war is so much harder."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.